And the baker gave Jack 5 beans in exchange for his cow, keeping 1 for himself.
Welcome to Putting It Together, the podcast that goes through the entire body of work of Stephen Sondheim, show by show and song by song. My name is Kyle Marshall, your self-described Sondheim expert. As I mentioned later in the episode, we're going to be talking about probably the shortest song we have ever discussed on this show, which is why we're pairing 2 songs together this week. Otherwise, I don't know how full of a conversation we really could have had. Luckily, Nathan Beary Blustein is back to lend his expertise in our discussion as we go through the songs of Into the Woods. I do want to call this out here, though. When I ask Nathan about what his favorite fairy tale is at the very end of the episode, he couldn't remember the name of it, but we discovered what it was after we finished recording. So I just wanted to throw that out there. Der Blonde Eckbert. That's as good as my German is probably going to be here for you this week. But that is a fairy tale that he's mentioning. It's from Ludwig Tieck or Tieck. T-I-E-C-K. It does sound wild. I do recommend going and reading the Wikipedia page about it, because it will send you on a roller coaster of emotions. Anyways, we have a very deep discussion to get into here, so let's get into my conversation about the 2 songs, I Guess This Is Goodbye and Maybe They're Really Magic.
I guess this is goodbye, old pal. You've been a perfect friend.
Nathan Beary Blustein, thank you so much for coming back.
Thanks very much for having me, Kyle.
You know, you've been here before, of course. And I think a lot of people will know you from some of your TikTok videos about, explaining certain songs from musical theater. I want to talk specifically about Into the Woods, obviously, because that's the season we're in. Do you remember your first introduction to this show?
I do. So this is probably the first show that I have a memory of, like, kicking myself for taking so long to get into. Because I remember, like, doing a little bit of theater in high school, but I never ended up doing any Sondheim, although I saw the Sweeney Todd movie, of course. That was out when I was in high school, not to date myself too precisely. But when I was, having conversations with other, like, classmates who were really interested in theater, they were talking about this musical, Into the Woods, and I was like, oh, that sounds kind of, I don't know, weird. and then a few years later, one of my first music directing jobs was for Into the Woods. So I figured I should finally get into the show. I mean, I think by then I had probably seen the PBS broadcast of the musical and been completely enchanted by it. My memory's a little fuzzy there. But really, it wasn't until I was the music director for a production. It was a summer stock theater. It was a cast of 10. We were sort of doing a riff on Fiasco Theater.
Oh, yeah.
Their stripped down version. So our same actress who was playing Rapunzel was playing Cinderella. We had a Florinda Wolf, Cinderella's Prince double, and a Lucinda Milky White Rapunzel's Prince double. So a lot of fun stuff happening in that particular production. Yeah, it was just me at the piano, and then a couple cast members occasionally would play auxiliary instruments. So I got to really dive into the score pretty quick. It was, and I mean, we were doing some in northeastern New Mexico. We were in the middle of nowhere. And so we were spending all this time just talking about Into the Woods in our free time. I had brought the Sondheim lyric books with me. And so that was really, Into the Woods ended up being my biggest, fullest, truest introduction to Sondheim. And
that's amazing.
Was just overwhelmed in the best way.
I mean, because you've had that experience then, what is it like, I guess, just devoting your time so much with the score? Is there something that was revealed to you from spending so much time with it?
It is a really intimidating score, as opposed to all that other Sondheim, which is so easy to play. I think that having a chance to try and figure out what it was that people were going to be paying attention to in terms of the details, because, you know, with just me at the piano, for the most part, I had to really do a lot of picking and choosing in terms of the resplendence of Jonathan Tunick's orchestration what I was going to ultimately be able to stick with. So there was a lot of, like, on my own time figuring that out. But then also in terms of working with the actors, they were asking a lot of really interesting questions. I mean, but they were also kind of basic ones. So, like, for example, when Cinderella's prince and Rapunzel's prince run into each other before agony starts, like, where did they both come from? Those kinds of questions, like trying to figure out like what feels like a reliable answer. And that was also my first experience of, oh, these are things that like actors in any production are going to be asking themselves, because I was still kind of a novice to the world of musical theater and the dramatic, especially the dramatic elements of it. And so getting a sense of how both for something that was like written out to be so detailed, and so just marveling at a bunch of detailed work. I'd also known the actress that was the witch on this production from my time in grad school. And so she and I had been spending a lot of time going over quite a bit of the witch's music and just like discovering some really thrilling details and diving into some really kaleidoscopic harmonies. And so, yeah, it was kind of hard to do something that felt paced and organized. I think that like I tend to be a little, my attention can get sort of like diverted pretty easily whenever I'm supposed to otherwise be like very focused and regimented and like going through like the step-by-step process of working on a show. And boy, does Into the Woods really invite that kind of thinking, just like going all over the place, continually discovering stuff as it crops up.
Well, you bring up something really important too, I think, as far as like coming as an actor into this piece, and I would assume as a director of this piece as well. There's certainly things within the text that answer those questions. But I do think a lot of this is up to interpretation of like, how are the woods like literally mapped out, like where is this person going and where are they going to and how do they cross paths with this character?
Totally.
You could just leave that up and like whatever, it's a show type of thing, but I think it does lend itself to like, no, we have to map this out so that we can give there be an acting reason about where you're going, what your motivation is, and then going into a song or into a scene that you're
a part of. I've done this show in three different productions. So my first one was more or less me at the piano with a couple actors stepping in. I have a story about the piano, by the way, if you're interested in hearing about like old instruments, but that can also be for another time. And then I did a production when I was teaching at American University. It was me on piano and then flute, French horn, and cello. So a very stripped down orchestra, but an orchestra to speak of. And we were doing it in a black box theater. So it was also like very crowded, but it was a blast. And when we were working with this group of college students on this production, one of the things that especially the director, who was really fabulous, kept asking the actors and challenging them on was, where is it that you're coming from? Where is the urgency of this coming from? And then more recently than that, I finally got to play part of the full orchestration at a theater in the DC area. And I was playing keys one for it. And even then, I was discovering a whole bunch about the score that was still new for me, just like some detail work, because I was finally diving into like a single instrument and playing that night after night and realizing like, oh, there's just a ton of stuff that even after writing a dissertation chapter and doing this show twice, I've missed out on. And I think in that production, I also got to see some actors who I sort of joined like in the middle of the run. I got to see some actors who were bringing their own version of that like absolute rock solid clarity with them. And so they were able to like really hold the audience's attention.
I brought this up during our episode on the prologue, but there is a video you can watch on YouTube that is just like the VHS rip of what you would get from MTI if you were putting on Into the Woods.
Oh, yes.
And there you have Sondheim literally explain like, this is how you need to start the show on the piano. This is the vamp, and this is why it has to be played this way sort of thing. Which, again, I will say, the only reason to watch this video is if you're kind of interested in it, because it's a slightly boring VHS video. But but it was fascinating to me to hear, like, no, like, it's easy for a keys player or a piano player to get into, like, a different rhythm, but it has to be this very specific measured beat that we're doing, or else it'll like make the whole thing fall apart.
Well, also that there are some parts that are, and honestly, like, this is some of the most intimidating stuff in the score, is just playing those like, sorry, I haven't done a keyboard test of this yet, but are you able to hear, is that coming through?
Oh yeah.
Just playing the like like that over and over again is honestly some of the scariest stuff in the show, because it does need to have like a uniformity and an urgency and character in it. And you can't deviate from it. So, right. Yeah, I would say that, like, the more you get a sense of just how important that, like, through scoring is in that opening scene, the more those little tiny details, or those, like, little, like, chords that just, like, are chugging along, honestly take on, for me, a more intimidating character than any of the flashy stuff that any of the instruments also get to do.
What's your piano story?
Oh, okay. So when I did the show for the first time in New Mexico, we had two options for the piano that I was going to play. One of them was a beautiful, well-maintained Steinway baby grand piano, which honestly, like, would have looked a little strange on the stage, like with this, with the concept of any Into the Woods production. Like, sleekness and elegance don't really, like, as far as the visual of the instrument, mm-hmm. like it was such a beautiful piece of musical machinery. And then I also had an option of this old upright piano. I think it was like from just the very turn of the 20th century. It was an upright piano. It had sort of like a, I don't quite remember if it was like a beige or anyway, it was not the fanciest instrument around, right? The sound right. quality of it was pretty good, but definitely not a more recently made Steinway. And this piano had five pedals attached to it instead of three. A typical piano has a sustain pedal. It has a, an upright will have as its middle pedal, like a practice pedal that you can depress and move around, and it'll create this like barrier of felt against the hammers so that it'll mm-hmm. be like much, much softer. And then there's the una corda pedal, which shifts the strings so that you're only playing one string at a time. This piano had five pedals, and one of them depressed a row, not of felt, but of metal balls, so that when you struck each one of them, it would sound kind of like something between like a harpsichord and a clavichord, okay. as opposed to a piano sound. In most musicals, you're not going to use that. But in a musical where a character like the witch enters to the sound of a harpsichord, it ends up being kind of perfect. So I said, I'd like that one, please. And it was in a different building, so they had to transport it by forklift into the theater. So they had to like strap it to a forklift and then drive the forklift to the back of the theater and raise it up to the level of the entrance to the backstage. While they were driving it, the forklift ran out of fuel. So it was like the piano was a few feet in the air in the middle of the road, and there was no way to move it. And I was looking up at the sky, and the director later said, I thought you were praying. And I was like, no, I was looking to see if it was going to rain and this instrument, this artifact, yeah. this antique was going to be ruined. And so because, and it was like, it was on a Sunday and it was in a very small populated town. So like a board member of the theater had to drive 15 miles to the nearest Walmart to get propane and bring it back. Yeah, we were just like stranded with this piano, just sort of hanging out. It is one of the more like surreal music experiences I've had, and the most worried I've ever been for a material item.
Yeah, yeah, you're just checking to make sure like birds aren't flying over
exactly.
it.
Exactly. Yes.
Just like, yeah. What is going
to
happen?
Thankfully, all was well. We got it into the theater. I was able to do the run with that instrument, mm-hmm. and it was really great. Like to just be able to like press a pedal and then all of a sudden switch over to this really great sound effect when the witch entered. It was, from my perspective, it was worth it.
You're known as being a teacher online, and I thought that this would be a great episode to jump into a more detailed conversation about a couple of the musical themes that run sure. through this show. In particular, because it pertains to the songs we're talking about here this week, the bean theme that runs through this. So I don't know if there's anything specific you want to bring up about that.
Well, for one, in terms of, there are some resources. I'll make sure to mention this straight mm-hmm. away. The YouTube creator Sideways has a really wonderful video about the bean theme. If anyone listens to this overview and you're seeking more, I would mm-hmm. also encourage you to give that a look. What I'll say is, so what we're talking about here is this five note motive, and it sounds like this. And we end up hearing it in a bunch of different contexts. The first time that we hear it is when the witch enters in the prologue. And then I think one of the next times that we hear it is when she comes back, right before the musical numbers that we're going to be talking about a little bit later. This is one of like a few different themes. And with the spell chord, that's an example of how Sondheim like wrote The Witch. When I interviewed him for my dissertation, one of the things that he mentioned was that every single one of her entrances, just like how in that YouTube video from MTI you were talking about, like the opening of the show should be a surprise, every time the witch enters should also be a surprise. And so she has these very evocative sounding chords. Okay, here we go. So let me see if I can play this on my little two-octave keyboard. Oh, wait, I literally can't because the notes are too expansive. I think that this is the arrangement of them. Yeah. There we go. So there's one of those entrances. Yeah. And so the bean theme is happening over this. So we have happening at the same time. This is when right after Hello Little Girl. Right. But there's no way that you can like take this group of notes and recreate the bean theme from them. On top of this five note theme, you also have this super thorny chromatic stinger that that accompanies the entrance. So we're getting a lot of the notes of the scale at a single moment here.
I guess the bean theme though does play a part later on in Stay With Me, correct?
Oh, absolutely. So it's in a lot of the witch's material, which makes sense given the provenance, the reason that the theme is there in the first place, right? And then it also ends up factoring into some of the other characters' music. So eventually we're going to hear it. We're going to hear it at the beginning of I Guess This Is Goodbye. We're going to hear it when the beans are referenced by some of the other characters. We're going to hear it as like a foundational part of Jack's theme in Giants in the Sky. So all of the songs where characters are learning lessons have a couple musical characteristics in common with Jack's song. So he's singing, there are giants in the sky. And his theme that he sings has the bean theme like baked into it, right? It's combined with this opening gesture of ba ba bum and then ba da 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 dum, and then his song just like takes that fragment of the bean theme and just runs with it. But all of the characters who have these lesson learning songs end up having this like musical characteristic of this opening gesture of ba da dum ba ba da dum, and then Little Red sings and I know things now, and then Cinderella sings you think what do you want, and then The Baker's Wife kind of has something like it, but kind of not really. And the fact that she has a lesson learning song at all is kind of a surprise in and of itself. But so there's this like motivic connection among all these characters. For Jack, he's singing part of the bean theme within his music. And that also like that also returns in Your Fault when all the characters are rehashing the course, right. the sequence of events. And we get, well, I jumped down the beanstalk, right? That's clear. Right. And we get this return of the bean theme just cycling over and over itself. And there it's a little bit less of like a fascination or like exuberance. And maybe it's a little like fixation or desperation.
That's cool. I don't know. Any other tidbits that you love?
Yes. Okay. So in Your Fault in particular, I guess there are two in Act Two. So there's one in Your Fault, which just like kind of bowled me over when I realized exactly what was happening. Because like, you know, of course, Act One is like all the fairy tales happening and the chaos and the characters like starting to kind of run into each other. And then like it unfolds as a farce, and then all of their wishes come true and they get what they want. And then Act Two is the consequences of that. And one of the ways that we get a sense of that musically is in Your Fault, we get this chorus of, so it's your fault, so it's your fault. Yes, it is. It's not. It's true. Right? The ba-da-dum-bum-bum-bum-bum, which is from the finale of Act One. Journey over. All is mended. Da-da-dum-dum-dum-dum-dum.
Right, right, right.
So we're getting this like tune that was triumphant at the end of Act One, talking about how the story is over, returning in Your Fault as a like, what is it that exactly went wrong and who is responsible for it? So that's one that I did not realize for years and years. And then I would say the other one, and this one's kind of always been my favorite, it's one that I've posted about on TikTok, in Moments in the Woods, when the baker's wife has just had her encounter with Cinderella's prince, and she's recalling it, and Cinderella's prince's music during any moment has this sort of lovely like this sort of like kind of waltz-ish accompaniment. When the baker's wife is singing, was that him, was that me, we get this return of it coming back. And then later on in the song, she is singing about how she should get, as she puts it, back to life, back to sense, how she should get back to the baker. And then she sings, "Why not both instead?" And while she's singing, "Why not both instead?" She's singing a melody from one of her duets with the baker, right? "If you could see." And then right. Underneath that, she's singing. The accompaniment is this sort of like flowing da 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 da, which is recalling the Cinderella's Prince music. So she's singing a tune from that she sang with the baker above an accompaniment that accompanied Cinderella's Prince while she's saying the line, "Why not both instead?" And I first realized that while I was working on some dissertation writing, probably back in like 2017, 2018, I still haven't gotten over it.
So what you're trying to really say here is that this music isn't all that complex.
Yeah, it's pretty straightforward. You're going to get... Well, it's kind of a funny thing about Into the Woods is that, like, I've heard from quite a few people who are fans of maybe some shows like Sweeney Todd or Company, or like some of Sondheim's earlier work, that Into the Woods and Sunday, sort of in the same breath, have this really repetitive feel to them. And I see where they're coming from. I think that is coming at an expectation of the score that just doesn't quite match like exactly what's going on. I mean, part of what gives this feel of repetitiousness is that there's this sort of like almost continuous musical undercurrent. And so there are these moments that are set to music, but aren't really full-fledged songs because they're not supposed to be. And if you are treating those the same as you would the fully-fledged songs, then you're probably going to come away from a show like Sunday or Into the Woods feeling kind of disappointed. But if you're getting a sense of like how cinematic this music ends up being, then I think you're going to find a more fulfilling experience.
Hey everyone, just kind of breaking into the conversation to tell you about some of the people that help make this show continue to go. If you'd like to help support the show for absolutely free, you can give a rating and review on whatever app you listen to podcasts in. That's, of course, greatly appreciated. Putting It Together is an independent podcast, so if you'd like to help monetarily, which will only help to grow and make this show better, you can do so over at our Patreon page. Please do not donate if it impacts you negatively financially. I would like to give a specific shout out to our newest patron here this week. That's Sixto Montesenios. Thank you so much for joining the Patreon over there. You yourself can become a patron by going to patreon.com/puttingittogetherpodcast. I also need to give a huge thank to the God That's a Good tier from Patreon of Barry, Derek, Alex, Christopher G, Christopher L, Jack, Luis, Mike, Robert, Stephen, Todd, and Witty. All right, let's get back to the show. What are we talking about here today? What songs are we talking about?
Oh, yeah. So we're looking at the most tragic moment in the show when Jack gives up Milky White. And the quarreling that happens after that between the baker and his wife. So we're looking at, I guess this is Goodbye and Maybe Their Magic.
Now, can you recall, like, right before these moments happen, these moments in the woods happen, what's happening right before this?
Yeah, so right before, the baker has just seen the impending horror of what's going to happen to Little Red after she has her first encounter with the wolf. And he also realizes that the poor Little Red also has this thing that he wants, which is her cape. And then the witch tells him to, as she puts it, forget about the little girl and get the cape. Just ignore everything else. Just go for the thing, the item that you need. He starts having a minor anxiety/amnesia-related freakout where he can't remember exactly what ingredients to get. And the baker's wife has followed him and starts singing a reminder of the things that he should be picking up. This like little mini reprise of what the two of them had sung in the prologue. And they return to, it's like they're about to get stuck in this infinite loop of whose house the spell is on, whether it's just the baker's or the baker and his wife's house. And before they can spin off into eternity, just trying to figure out whose house the spell is on, they discover Jack, who is just sort of absentmindedly wandering through the forest after he was getting negged by the mysterious man.
I was going to say, I think the mysterious man shows up here in this moment, too. And is this the first time we're seeing the mysterious man in the show? I'm trying to remember.
Oh, yes, that's right. Yeah, so that's right. So they have this encounter. They have this first meeting. And so the baker is trying to convince. Well, let's see. Who is trying to do the convincing here? So they're having this conversation where the baker's wife is gently encouraging the baker to get Jack to give them the cow. And Jack is a little hesitant until he finds out that from the baker's wife that the beans that they're offering, beans in exchange for my cow, that the beans are magic. And the magic, the best way that the baker can describe it is that they are magic beyond description. And then the mysterious man, that's right, he shows up again and he heckles Jack one more time to say, you'd be lucky to exchange your cow for a sack of beans. And they make the exchange. And that's when Jack is finally about to part with his beloved Milky White.
Something that can only truly happen in a fairy tale environment where it's like, go and get money for this thing. But magic beans trumps money, obviously.
Obviously. I think the line where Jack says beans in exchange for my cow is one of those moments where, you know, something else that Sondheim and Lapine would talk about every now and then is they were kind of surprised how much in the text they had to like remind people in the audience about the fairy tales. And so when Jack says this line, right, beans in exchange for my cow, it to me like sticks out a little bit as like, oh, we're going to like recite the fairy tale here. But yes, it's a pretty crucial part of the story. Right.
My lovable character that he is, but basically this entire book scene and then into this kind of song fragment we're about to talk about, it just like underscores the fact that this is just a young and dumb kid that is trying to make his way in the world.
Yeah, and there are a couple different ways to play him. Like obviously in the movie, he's played by a child actor. And in most productions, I think it seems like it's kind of up to the production to determine like whether or not it is a older actor who is playing a younger child or an older character who is seeing the world through a child's eyes. Right. And it seems like it really does depend on the production.
I'm just going to read out the full text here of I Guess This Is Goodbye, because that kind of makes the most sense. It's a very short piece here where he's saying goodbye, of course, to Milky White and says, I guess this is goodbye, old pal. You've been a perfect friend. I hate to see us part, old pal. Someday I'll buy you back. I'll see you soon again. I hope that when I do, it won't be on a plate.
I guess this is goodbye, old pal. You've been a perfect friend. I hate to see us part, old pal. Someday I'll buy you back. I'll see you soon again. I hope that when I do, it won't be on a plate.
I'm pretty sure this is literally the shortest song that this show has covered at this point. But that is the full thing.
Well, so when I interviewed Sondheim, one of the things that he mentioned with this song in particular, it just sort of like came up as an aside, and I wanted to know so much more, and I haven't seen the manuscripts for it, but it was this more fully fledged song. Let me see if I can find the transcript anywhere. So he said, well, that was a song, but now it's a fragment. And I said, I didn't know that. It was a full chorus song, and I reduced it to four lines. Yeah, I guess it is ultimately two couplets and then like another couplet plus. Mm-hmm. So ultimately, I guess that's how he gets to four with his arithmetic. But of course, like the big feature of this song lyrically is that there are no rhymes. In Look, I Made a Hat, Sondheim goes pretty extent, like into great detail about how he avoided rhyming or even the appearance of rhyming for this song.
Yeah. So I just want to point out he writes more about this song, this song fragment, than Giants in the Sky or like a bunch of the other songs in this show. Like he writes a lot about this little song fragment in his book.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. And I mean, with Giants too, like he talks about the couple of different versions that he that he had in mind for it. This is the show that I think Mark Horowitz mentioned in one of his articles about diving into like a particular Sondheim song. I think it might have been Children Will Listen. He mentions that this is the show for which the most amount of music was discarded. And it seems like a lot of it is Jack's.
Interesting.
There were just a lot of different ideas that he had for this character. It does seem like Jack is kind of like the character where he sort of really started fleshing out a lot of the ideas of the show. So unlike most shows where he was going in chronological order, I think he really did spend a lot of time. Is my understanding is that it seems like he was trying to work out exactly what the beginning, middle, and end of this particular fairy tale was going to look like.
Yeah. It's interesting. I've had this conversation now with a few different people this season about who are the protagonists of this show and like why these fairy tales, et cetera, et cetera.
Sure.
The one thing I keep coming back to is the two kid characters. Let me just take one small step back here. I think ultimately, this is not a hidden fact. This is very much a textual reading of this. This is a show that is investigating the relationship between children and parents and like the idea of parenthood, et cetera, et cetera. The two children characters, Little Red and Jack, while definitely important as far as plot things go, Jack gets this like sentence fragment. He gets giants in the sky. But just like Little Red, like their storylines are effectively wrapped up, in my opinion, in Act
totally.
One.
Yes.
And they
yes.
don't. They only get very hinted at in Act Two, where we focus a lot more, again, on Cinderella, on the baker and his wife. I could see what, at a certain point in the evolution of this show, is like, we want these characters to be here. We want them to feel like real characters. But also, if we keep writing stuff for them, this becomes a 4-hour show and we can't have a 4-hour show.
Well, that's interesting. Yes, absolutely. This with the order that we get these characters, like they're lesson learning songs, right?
Yeah.
When Little Red is singing hers, her story, like you said, is done. Like we've gotten to the end of the story of Little Red Riding Hood. And then when we get to Jack's, we've gotten to the first of his trips up the beanstalk. So we get some sort of ending, but he's still like, we also get a sense that he is still longing for that, like that in between of the comforts of home and the magic of the kingdom of the giant.
Right.
And then with Cinderella, like her song is all about how her story is not yet over. And so as these songs keep appearing over the course of the show, they're happening at times where each character's story is a little less wrapped up. And there's something kind of, this is the thing that I sort of focused on about these characters in my dissertation chapter on the show, is that each one of these songs where these characters are articulating like, okay, here's the thing that I'm experiencing learning right now for each one of them, like totally for the two children, they're singing something more or less conclusive. Even though with Jack, maybe it's a little more ambiguous. And then with Cinderella and then later on the baker's wife, it is much more open-ended. And musically too, like the organization of their songs is much fuzzier. Like if you try to say like, okay, I know that this is the moment that this song shifts from like this section to this section, it's a little less clear with their songs.
This is something that is interesting to notice here. The more that I investigate this show, like how things get resolved and wrapped up, it's just kind of a fascinating thing to like dig into about how they subtly show all these fairy tale characters. They all get wrapped up. And then we dig a little bit deeper in Act Two. But there are a few of the characters that in my opinion, kind of get shoved to the side a little bit.
Oh, sure.
So we can dig into like the deeper stuff.
One interesting thing, though, about Jack and Little Red is that they are the first two characters from different stories to run into each other. And toward the end of Act One, Jack is walking around with his hen that lays golden eggs, and with the golden egg itself. And then Little Red is walking around with her new maid cape and knife. And that's the first moment that things are starting to get like especially messy is like, oh, finally, it's not just the baker and his wife at the center of all of these stories, but these characters are starting to like talk to and learn from and discover each other.
Anything else I guess you want to say about this very short, I guess this is goodbye?
Forgive me for getting so sidetracked there. But with this song, the other thing that I want to point out is how the bean theme works in this particular number. So this moment opens with, this is my best approximation of it, on a piano sounding keyboard. But when the baker is giving Jack the beans, each one of them is accompanied by like on the xylophone for each one. And then there's that little bit of pause, and then he gives the last one. And then there's, I think, like a cello pizzicato moment where we get the baker like shoving the sixth bean back into his pocket. And then we get one of the most gorgeous cello solos, which is just the bean theme again. Or I guess it's an octave higher. But just imagine that this is a cello. And it's that bean theme again, but then it gets fragmented. And we just hear those last three notes over and over and over again. And then while Jack is singing, "I guess this is goodbye," he sings, "I guess this is goodbye, old pal," which is actually a flipped around version of that fragment of the bean theme. So while the cello is playing this,
right,
Jack is singing this, and we get this sort of quasi-mirror image of this fragmented motive. So the bean theme is showing up everywhere within this particular song, just after the exchange for Milky White has been finalized.
Which does make sense, seeing how like he is most known because of a beanstalk. You would think that the bean theme would become very prevalent within his storyline.
Sure.
I was going to say, I'm glad you brought this back around, because one of the things that Sondheim writes about is like, yes, this is such a short song, but let me tell you about why it takes a lot of time and effort to make something this short still feel complete. He says, like, there's no rhymes. The trouble that he found himself in is that friend and again can somewhat sound like he was trying to rhyme them, and he's like, not on my watch. So he has to separate them enough so that people don't think that he's trying to rhyme those two words together.
If you put these two bits of the song together, then you get Jack singing, "You've been a perfect friend," and then, "I'll see you soon again." And if you put those two like right next to each other, then yeah, they do sound kind of like a slant rhyme. So so the fact that like one of them, "You've been a perfect friend," is at the end of one of the phrases, and then "I'll see you soon again" is at the beginning of another phrase. And then you also have, like, I think Sondheim mentions, like, the harshness of the phrase, "Someday I'll buy you back." He has all these explosive consonants happening in between to sort of, acting as kind of like a palate cleanser, which I didn't realize consonants could do until Sondheim described it in this number, but it totally makes sense.
And then at the end of this, at least on the original Broadway cast, this is me always being unsure if it's the instrument I think it is it's playing. It sounds like it's a flute solo, I'm pretty sure. Or at least it's some sort of woodwind that is being played at the end of it. It's, again, a beautiful segue into maybe their magic.
And there's also another fragment of bean theme segue that's happening here. So there's that lovely flute solo that's happening. Then at the same time, you still have the strings continuing this motive. And that's in E major. And then right after that, we switch keys to B major, and this last note turns into the top note of that same fragment. So that's the signal that we're in our new musical scene. And then eventually that's going to turn into, it's going to expand just a little further. But yeah, it's in with maybe their magic, we're still just in the accompaniment. Somewhere is this vestige of the bean theme still running through.
There is this short book scene. I'm doing this from memory, but it essentially breaks down to like the baker giving a huge amount of side eye to his wife and being like, "Magic beans." And she's like, "Well, do you want a child or not?" And he's like, "Are we to dispel this curse through deceit?" Something like that.
Uh-huh. He is, he's questioning the methods that they just used to acquire this essential ingredient for them to have a child. Yeah, that's right. The five beans is the thing that he shouts at her before she starts her tirade. There's a couple fun, more fun musical things about her particular melody, but we should, I guess, get to what she's saying.
She sings, "If you know what you want, then you go and you find it and you get it." And the baker points, "Home. Do we want a child or not? And you give and you take and you bid and you bargain, or you live to regret it. Will you please go home? There are rights and wrongs and in-betweens. No one waits when fortune intervenes. And maybe they're really magic. Who knows?"
If you know what you want, then you go and you find it and you get it.
Home.
Do we want a child or not? And you give and you take and you bid and you bargain, or you live to regret it.
Will you please go home?
There are rights and wrongs and in-betweens. No one waits when fortune intervenes. And maybe they're really magic. Who knows?
Why you... First of all, the baker pointing and saying home, like, how wonderfully dismissive.
Right.
So the baker's wife's melody here, the "if you know what you want," right, it's a bringing back of what Cinderella's mother sings earlier on in the show when she's singing to Cinderella. She sings, "Do you know what you wish?" Right. But instead of wish, here the baker's wife is saying want. And in Cinderella's mother's music, it's very like flowy, and maybe keeping track of like the musical meter is a little ambiguous. But for the baker's wife, it's like in this strict 4-4 time. We can count along to it without any sense of ambiguity. And so this is one of the motives that's like being shared between characters, maybe not necessarily because there's some like deep connection between Cinderella's mother and the baker's wife, right, like save for like the theme of motherhood. This is something that like is maybe for the audience's sake, as opposed to like these characters are aware that they're both singing the same thing. The other thing that I'll mention is that Sondheim has this, for Into the Woods, he had this list of musical themes. I think at one point he does refer to it as a cheat sheet. He actually writes quite a bit for Maybe They're Magic. Let me see if I can pull it up here.
That'd be great.
This is something that gets transcribed in Horowitz's interview books, or interview book with Sondheim, Sondheim on Music, Minor Details and Major Decisions. Yeah, like the very first thing in this list is just the "I wish more than anything," but it's just the notes themselves and a chord symbol underneath. And then the word "wish" is written on top of that. So it's that sort of thing, right? And so there are motives for the birds. And then there's a motive that's labeled beans, and the letter J is written right next to it to symbolize, you know, that this is associated with Jack. And in fact, there's also like goodbye, G'BYE, for I guess this is goodbye, old pal. And then later on, there's the wish/want, and it's written for Cinderella's mother to sing, and it's written, and then that's the "and you shall have your wish." And then it also says CFMIM want, which I think is like the Maybe They're Magic. There's also some motives that just like don't appear anywhere in the song Maybe They're Magic. So there's one that's written MTM parentheses Maybe They're Magic, and this is what it sounds like. And there's just that theme is not anywhere in that song. Okay. So there was some stuff that got discarded too. And then lastly, the last motive that I'll mention here is MTM is written, so ba-ba-bum-ba-dum, as opposed to Maybe They're Really Magic. It was originally going to be Maybe They're Magic, but it's possible that like maybe that alliteration was a little too close together for Sondheim's taste, and he eventually changed it. But yeah, it was originally also another like 5-note theme that turns into something that's a little more expansive in the final version. So yeah, there's a lot just like within this long list of themes that's happening only in this couple, this less than a minute of music that we've gotten to so far.
I just like her quick justification. Like, this is in such a stark contrast, her and her husband told through a song, because it's like, well, maybe they are magic. Who knows? Like,
yes, the fact that she like pivots over, and like she has been singing this stuff that rhymes. And by the way, like the number of infinitives in this show is just, I do not envy anyone who has to memorize all of the infinitives for this musical. But for her, yeah, has this pivot on, and maybe they're really magic, who knows? And neither magic nor knows rhymes with anything in this song. So her sort of this justification, I think it's kind of strange that it doesn't end up having a rhyme with anything else. And maybe that heightens the fact that it is
It really is like a parenthetical and kind of in the middle of the song.
Totally. Yes.
I do want to just bring up some of the like what she is actually talking about here, right? So the setup here in this first half is like, listen, if there's something that you want in this world, you just go and you get it. And it doesn't, no matter if like you're giving something, taking something, bargaining, whatever. We know there's right and there's wrong in this world, but if there's something you truly want, you just go out and you take it. Which for a character that I think a lot of people love or at least enjoy watching is a pretty destructive worldview, if I'm going to put like a morality on this.
Yeah, I mean, I think that the baker's wife ends up being, we have this view of this character as being a protagonist who is seeking the quest of being able to have a child. And that is something that we are going to sympathize with. But then also, like, we have this challenge of this almost literally Machiavellian character who also, like, ends up having this affair, isn't quite the right word for mm-hmm. it in Act Two.
A tryst of some kind, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And she's a character who is, her eagerness, right? Her capacity to get like swept up in where the story is headed, I think seems to be part of what distinguishes her from the baker who is so hesitant and nervous. And this is the, I think this is a reason why the baker's wife tends to, I you know, when I like posted this video about Moments in the Woods, I had a lot of people comment like about like how problematic of a character the baker's wife was. And part of that was like this desire for all this like desire for all characters in all stories to be, who aren't villains, to be morally upstanding in all ways. And you're not going to get that in a Sondheim musical, but also not necessarily granting the fact that like the baker's wife is so ready to be so fully invested. And without that investment, we're not going to get the rest of this story, for better and for worse.
Right. I think it also puts her into stark contrast with Cinderella specifically. Cinderella is a character who waits for things to happen.
Yes.
And yeah. The baker's wife is someone who is actively making things happen. So it's another interesting wrinkle in this, is that at least for my reading, like Cinderella and the baker end up together at the end of this. So there's, yeah, this interesting journey that this show takes you on.
Well, by the end of the show, of course, like they've all had these kind of remarkable shifts. And with the baker's wife, where she eventually lands is, oh, this drive to find like the fairy tale version of things, right? Mm-hmm. I set out on this quest. I have this whirlwind tryst, right? And these are all things that like can fit into the beginning, middle, and end of a narrative. But then there's also the living with it after the fact. Of course, like just too late, she realizes that the living with it after the fact is the thing that really ultimately matters.
Yeah, and I don't know about you, but I find that when me and like a disparate group of other people commit a major murder, it brings us closer together. There's also that.
You know, so like with the musical that I'm doing right now, there's a line where someone says, we did kill someone though, and then one of the other characters says, yes, but we did it together. And so
right.
What I'm trying to say is, Into the Woods walked so that Beetlejuice could run.
Okay, so this is how the song ends. So the baker's wife continues on singing, why you do what you do, that's the point. All the rest of it is chatter. Look at her, she's crying. If the thing you do is pure in intent, if it's meant and it's just a little bent, does it matter? Yes. No, what matters is that everyone tells tiny lies. What's important really is the size. Only three more tries and we'll have our prize. When the end's in sight, you'll realize if the end is right, it justifies the beans.
What you do, that's the point. All the rest of it is chatter.
Look at her, she's crying.
If the thing you do is pure in intent, if it's meant and it's just a little bent, does it matter?
Yes.
No, what matters is that everyone tells tiny lies. What's important really is the size. Only three more tries and we'll have our prize. When the end's in sight, you'll realize if the end is right, it justifies the beam.
Can you imagine what it must have felt like to have come up with that?
It is like one of, in my opinion, kind of an iconic end of a song.
Oh, of course.
And I also love, you can find this on TikTok and YouTube, of like every actress does that reading differently. The justifies the beans absolutely. Line. Like no one has ever done it the same way, it seems like. So it's fun to see how people interpret it.
I think there's a TikTok user whose username is Finn to the Woods. And he has a compilation.
I'm trying to get him on the show. We'll see if that actually ever happens.
Okay. All right. Finn to the Woods, come on, putting it together. So he has that compilation of justifies the beans through the ages. And like, so we'll work our way back to the rest of the lyrics. But I have to say, I don't know if the end of it needs to be belted, but there is something just like so forgive, pun not intended, but like magical about Stephanie J. Block's outburst at the end of this song.
If the end is right, it justifies the beat.
Difficult to like have a set opinion on like which version seems the most appropriate when I know like in my being I am drawn to the shiny thing of fantastic, unexpected, high belt. But
I think it just depends too on like what part of that phrasing do you think is the most important. If it was me, like no one would ever ask me to be the baker's wife, but if they were, it just feels like justifies is the thing you want to hit on there. It justifies what I'm about to go and do rather than going high on the beans. But I don't know, maybe that's just me overthinking things.
It took me kind of a long time to realize that justifies is a rhyme.
Sure, yeah.
That like it is the end of this long string of I's rhymes. Of course, because as soon as we hear if the end is right, it justifies, we're already thinking of where that sentence is supposed to end. And this is another moment where there isn't a rhyme with the word in the song proper. Beans doesn't rhyme with anything, but it rhymes with the word that we think we're going to hear. So Sondheim, in that way, I guess, like, has his cake and eats it too. But yeah, like you're saying, justifies is the most literal target in the sense that it is the final rhyme in this very long string of just rhyming the same sound over and over and over again, which just speaks to the baker's wife just having this sort of like certainty and drive to her.
Yeah. And I do like the baker's asides here, because I think at least for part of the audience, I think he is the voice of reason in this song, which is like when she says like, listen, if the thing you're doing is pure, then who cares if like the actions are a little bit nebulous? It's like, does that matter? It's like, yeah, it does matter. Like what you're doing. It's not in the text that I read out here, but like what's important really is the size. Like in most recordings, the baker's like, what are you talking about?
I don't think I've seen that. I don't remember like if it's in the score or if it's in a published version of the libretto. I've been in the materials that I have, the what isn't actually anywhere in written text.
Gotcha.
But of course, like you're saying, it is something that we get in a lot of versions. I do love the like strict rhythm that we get of the no, yes, or yes, no. Just a lovely musical moment there. The fact that like the music has to keep going, and so the baker can't actually be listened to there, or his answer can't actually be like taken into account. Yeah, and like you're saying, the fact that the baker's wife is saying like, no, the reason for why we're doing all of these and will be doing all of these screwed up things as our story continues, that's the important thing. What happens in the actual moments is not really what we're paying attention to. The fact that our motives the fact that the motive is pure, right? That's the thing that we have to remember.
Yeah, I think it's too, I mean, a lot of this is lessened because I think people coming into this are at least somewhat familiar with the fairy tale stories. So we know that Jack is going to buy these beans. Like, we just know that that's something that happens in the story.
Yeah.
So I don't think it seems as bad as how, I don't know, like tech bros or like influencers nowadays will use some of this similar language. It's like, well, if your heart is pure, it doesn't matter how you act to other people, because you know what you're doing is right. Even if they don't understand that what you're doing is right, this kind of weird philosophy. So I think as an audience member, you're like, okay, this is kind of a funny song at the end of the day, with these two married people being at odds with one another.
What we're saying here is that the baker's wife is a hardened believer in long-termism.
Exactly. Exactly what I'm trying to say.
Yeah.
But told in these like really compact rhymes that Sondheim is doing. Like I like the fact that like why you do what you do, that's the point. If the thing you do is pure in intent, if it's meant and it's just a little bent, does it matter? Like he's using this very clever language and compact rhymes to be pretty big concepts that she's trying to communicate.
Yeah, I mean, it's just a testament to, I don't know, maybe on that long walk to find where the baker was, the fact that like she gets there expecting him to be so ready to go, and like he's trying to figure everything out, and he's planning how he's going to be convincing each individual person. He's making little to-do lists. And then it turns out that he is forgetting the essentials of what he's supposed to be doing. Like she's giving kind of like an example of what could have been for the previous however many hours it's been that he's been out in the woods on his own. And so she's basically saying, like, not just expressing this philosophy, but also this like frustration that he is so reluctant to get to where he needs to be in like the appropriate frame of mind, but also like contradictorily has this view that like, no, I'm the man. I should be the one who is going out on this dangerous quest.
Right, right.
I'm the one who is responsible. And she's basically like lyrically knocking some sense into him.
I've seen how you've run this bakery. I think I know that I need to come here and help you out. What I was going to say too is that I think that subtly she does kind of rub off on him. As we see by the end of the first act, he goes and buys a cow and just like puts flour all over it. It's like, well, I have to make this work somehow. And so I'm just going to
A flawless plan. Yeah.
No holes to poke into this plan. Yeah. That being said, is there anything else that you think we need to say about either of these two songs?
Do you have anyone talking about the reprise, the Baker's reprise?
No, I don't think so. I don't think I'm doing most of the reprises as their own separate things.
I guess the only thing that I'll mention in addition then is that when the Baker is singing his reprise later, after Little Red stomps on his foot,
right,
he comes up with a line that sort of like approximates where the Baker's wife is. At this point, he says, things are only what you need them for. What's important is who needs them more.
Mm-hmm.
And so he's finally gotten to that place of, oh, no, wait, I really do need to set out on this in a way that's appropriate to the stakes at hand, appropriate to the urgency at hand.
If you know what you need, then you go and you find it and you take it. Do I want a child or not? It's a cloak. What's a cloak? It's a joke. It's a stupid little cloak. And a cloak is what you make it. So you take it. Things are only what you need them for. What's important is who needs them more.
And so the baker, with newfound determination, went after the red cape.
But it takes him sort of like tentatively trying something that absolutely doesn't work and completely backfires before he actually gets like that same fire under him to well and truly get going, such as it is. He's still pretty skittish as he keeps going.
So I'm treating these as two separate songs. So if we start with, I guess this is a goodbye. If you were to rate this song in the entirety of the score, would this be top five, middle five, bottom five? Where would it show up for you?
I presume that what you mean is top 25, middle 25, bottom 25, because there's
basically
there's a shocking amount of music in this show.
There's so much. I am doing this season until mid-April, everyone. Like, there's a lot of songs to get through.
Yep. It sort of depends on, is this the thing that I'm going to like return to over and over in my daily Sondheim listening? Probably not. But in terms of songs that I think are, I mean, I guess for that reason alone, I would sort of have to put it somewhere in the middle, maybe towards the bottom, but only because it pays off into a top five song later on.
Sure.
Right.
Yeah.
So like the fact that it's part of this thread that leads to Giants in the Sky, and it's kind of the same with maybe their magic. It has this really incredible vocal moment in it, but compared to some of the other stuff that the Baker's Wife sings, I mean, Moments in the Woods is kind of unbeatable in that sense.
Yeah, I'm probably similar to you, I'm actually keeping a running tally of how I'm rating these songs this season. For me, I guess This Is Goodbye is going at the bottom for now. It's like I don't hate it or anything like that. It just feels so slight that I'm not coming back and listening to just that by itself ever. So currently it is going underneath Cinderella at the Grave at the bottom of my list. The Maybe They're Really Magic is probably going to ultimately show up in the middle, but probably top of the middle is my guess. Currently is going to be going in at the number two. That's where it's going to enter the list at, but that's because we only have had a few songs. So it's going underneath the prologue, but above a Hello Little Girl is how I would put it. Just because the second half of that, this song is so fun to listen to me.
Absolutely. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, and I will say musically for the piano player, Maybe Their Magic has some really like wonderful figurations to play that are really satisfying. And you know, if you get them right, you can feel pretty accomplished. So I would probably put, I would put Maybe Their Magic somewhere above. I guess This Is Goodbye. If we're able to then sleep at night knowing that we have ranked the songs in order, then yes, then I'm fine with that.
If it makes you feel like a big man to go and rank songs. And as a wrap up, I now have just realized I forgot to tell you that I'm doing this. But as a wrap up, I'm asking everyone, what's your favorite fairy tale? So it could be a fairy tale that shows up inside of this musical. It could be a different one. Do you have a favorite fairy tale?
I have a really visceral memory in college of taking, I think it was, trying to remember what course it was, but it was, I was taking like, I think it was an advanced German class, and we were reading this fairy tale in German, and I wish that I could remember exactly what it was, but every time I think of fairy tales, I think of this extremely effed up story that was a fairy tale, and just like along the lines of Grimm's fairy tales in their original forms, as Sondheim and Lapine would talk about, like, oh, they're concerning, right?
Did it involve someone's thumbs getting cut off?
Right. Yeah, and I'm trying to remember if that's what it was. It was definitely bloody, and we were definitely told that it was a fairy tale. And so like the cognitive dissonance that I experienced from that fairy tale was kind of like how Sondheim talks about Giants in the Sky, not necessarily being about recounting the storytelling, but more what Jack felt. I don't remember the actual story, but I definitely remember how it felt to read.
Well, Nathan, thank you so much for doing this. If people wanted to stay in contact with you, see what you're up to, what's the easiest way to do so online?
Sure. So my TikTok is probably the place where I post the most stuff that would be relevant to listeners here. And that's my username on there is Rhapsody in Blue, but without the E at the end because of how my name is spelled. You know, you can also go to my website, which is also hard to spell. It's NathanBearyBlustein.com.
That's great. Perfect. Thank you once again.
Sure thing. Thanks so much, Kyle. Really, really appreciate being on here. And thanks again for dealing with all the fun internet connection stuff.
That's all right.
I think we got through it at the mercy of this Hampton Inn and Suites Wi-Fi.
Thank you. Not a sponsor, but thank you, the Hampton Inn and Suites.
Yeah, of course. Where would we be without them?
Then you go and you find it and you get it.
Thank you so much for listening. You can send emails to puttingittogetherpodcast@gmail.com. You can also follow Sondheim Podcast on Twitter or Instagram. This is an independent production, and you can support the show on Patreon by going to patreon.com/puttingittogetherpodcast. Putting It Together is available on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, and pretty much anywhere you can get podcasts from. Consider subscribing so that you never miss an episode. Next week, the song that really only appears in the London version, but we're going to talk about it anyway, it's Our Little World. Who doesn't want to climb up some hair? As always, a big thank you to the great Chris Taniguchi, who designed the podcast artwork, and Nick Driscoll for composing our theme music. Well, we've reached the end of our episode. Yes, I know. Goodbye for now.